And good morning, everybody, and welcome to this webinar, which is about cybersecurity as a business differentiator. There's no doubt that this is probably one of the most important priorities for boards to consider at this time. And we hope to bring you a series of insights around growth and resilience within cybersecurity, and what you can do as a board and executive teams to really secure your organisation and protect your reputation. Just a few pieces of housekeeping before we get started. We're going to be spending the next hour together, and as always, we'll be keeping a 15-minute slot available at the end of the webinar for questions and answers. So please do send your questions via the question and chat window in the top right hand corner of your screen, and we'll cover as many as we can. But what we always do is summarize those in a link to you after the event. If you want to ask a question direct to any of the speakers, that would be great. Just add their name with your question and I'll endeavour to make that happen. And apologies in advance if we have any unplanned interruptions to do with technology, dogs or deliveries. But we will be sharing the webinar at the end in the next day or two to you so that you can pick up any bits that you may have missed. Without further ado, I just want to introduce our panelists today, and I think this is going to be a very lively conversation, which I'm sure all of you who are watching have a vested interest. James Arthur will be starting the session with our panelist speakers. He's our head of cybersecurity here at Grant Thornton, and has extensive experience of working with a range of clients, identifying and taking their cybersecurity challenges in a proportionate manner. James will then be followed by Richard Manning. Richard is Chief Technical Officer for Economy and Society at the UK's National Cybersecurity Centre. Larry Hurst, CBE, has joined us as an independent chairman and director. He was formerly CEO of IBM UK and Ireland, and is Senior NED at Mighty Group PLC, Independent NED at Arm Group Holdings, and a UK Business Ambassador. Richard Knowlton is joining us from as a former director of group corporate security with Vodafone. He was director of security studies at the Oxford Cyber Academy. That's quite a mouthful, Richard, apologies. And I hope I've covered everybody there, but if I haven't, and I need to mention Nick Wilding, who Nick will be bringing this panelist session to a close with a very challenging session as General Manager Cyber Resilience at Axelis Global Best Practice, and it's Head of Resilia. So James is going to speak to you today about identifying and tackling cybersecurity challenges in a proportionate manager within your businesses. Over to you, James.
Thanks, Karen. Now, as Karen outlined, we're going to be covering a lot of ground in today's session with some very interesting speakers. But I wanted to start off by talking about the main reasons that our customers like to discuss cybersecurity with us. So the first and most obvious probably is to reduce the risk to their business of cyber attack, whether that be theft of intellectual property, leaking customer data, or key systems being taken offline as a result of ransomware or other attacks. Now, my team spend a lot of time talking to boards about the current cyber threats, especially from volume cybercrime, and about how very little activity is specifically targeted from the outset anymore. Cyber is now the most profitable type of crime in the world, and there's some pretty sophisticated business models being operated by cyber criminals who are constantly looking for vulnerable businesses to make easy money, irrespective of who they are. Now, we recognise that it's hard to keep everything protected all the time, and so we reuse a range of models to help boards quantify their current cyber risk by understanding what their key assets and data holdings are, what level of cybersecurity controls they have in place at the minute, and then using large data sets from actual attacks and fines to assess the potential financial impacts that could result from different types of attacks or accidental data leaks. Then we use this data to help them develop options to mitigate these risks in a cost-effective way. Now, putting in place improved cybersecurity isn't necessarily just about technology or expensive software solutions, and good cyber does not need to cost the earth. Now, the second reason that people often talk to us is about complying with regulation in order to avoid fines. There are new cybersecurity and data protection laws and regulations being brought out on a regular basis. Now, clearly these vary with the sector and geographies that you work in, but we've undertaken a number of reviews on behalf of regulators recently where companies have had data breaches or cyber issues affecting their customer data. I think it's fair to say that the regulators are getting more cyber aware and requiring increasing levels of detail on exactly what cyber controls were in place, who was responsible within the company, and what level of management and attention was spent on cyber when the issue happened, and moving forwards to make sure it doesn't happen again. Now, the third reason is the ability to win contracts. An increasing number of firms are insisting on companies in their supply chain signing up to minimum cybersecurity standards before awarding contracts. Sometimes this is formal accreditation, such as the UK government cyber essentials, or international standards, such as ISO 27001. But more often than not, we see it as companies asking their supply chain to abide by their cybersecurity standards and processes. Now, many businesses that we talk to have signed up to these without necessarily reading the detail and checking if they do comply can demonstrate that they comply, and therefore are running the risk that if they are the source of a data breach or cyber attack from that larger company, they could be held liable. In fact, just last week, we were asked to sign up to 40 pages of cyber standards as part of a master services agreement with a large international company in order to provide them with cyber advice, which I thought was fairly ironic. And finally, more and more firms are seeing cyber as a business differentiator. As more move online and start to accelerate their digital journeys and look to become trusted online brands. This ranges from making sure that their basic cyber hygiene is in place through to looking for examples of customer or corporate data on the dark web, through to practically looking for examples of their brand being hijacked to defraud customers or staff. Now, recently we've helped customers identify and deal with replica websites, criminals imitating their chief financial officers and MDs on social media, through to fake invoices being sent to their clients and suppliers and disrupting their operations. We found that few things can damage a brand as quickly as a cyber issue, and speed of reporting is only getting faster. Now, irrespective of which of these is your top reason to be thinking about cyber, we overwhelmingly find that having leadership at a board level is one of the most effective ways of minimising the chances of a successful attack and reducing the financial impact if an attack or breach do occur. Now, despite this, when we interviewed over 500 firms last year, only 37% had a board member with specific responsibility for cybersecurity and formally reviewed cyber risks and management at board level. Now, with that in mind, we'd be very interested in your views in a quick poll that will be on screen shortly in terms of who you think should be accountable for cybersecurity decisions and why. And while you take a second to look at that, I think it's worth just reflecting on the fact that choosing a board member to lead on cyber doesn't necessarily have to be somebody with a technology specialism. In fact, we see that the more cyber is viewed and treated as a business risk and discussed in non-technical language, the more that we see boards engaging with this. And if a company is serious about cybersecurity becoming a true business differentiator, there are three things that we always advise. Making sure that cybersecurity is the responsibility of a specific board member, regularly reviewing the cybersecurity risks and management at board level, and preparing a cyber incident response plan in order to help rapidly contain and minimise the impact of an attack if one does happen. Now, if we look at the results of the poll, I guess that's not entirely surprising. It's a fairly overwhelming view that it absolutely should be something that's on the board agenda, but supported by a specific cyber subcommittee with the right skills in place. Now, I'll hand over to Richard to take you through how the UK government has adapted advice for boards during this pandemic, the NCSC board toolkit, and how companies have applied this advice. So over to you, Richard.
Hi there. Good morning, everybody. Thanks for that. Hi, I'm Richard Manning, CTO for Economy Society at the NCSC. A brief bit of background at NCSC before I go crack on. NCSC is part of GCHQ. Our role is to support all our different sectors in the UK with independent and non-regulatory based advice and guidance. The sectors we cover cover the whole remit of what happens in the UK. So we have teams that look after defence, teams that look after government, teams that look after critical national infrastructure, and my area, Economy and Society, which covers the plethora of non-CNI businesses. So that's everything from FTSEs down to SMEs and everything in between, small companies, academia, universities, research, charities, and the citizen. So quite a broad remit of customers. Like I say, we're non-regulatory. We base all our research on science and back it all up. And behind all this, one of our main mission statement, something we sincerely believe in, is to, our aim is to keep make the UK a safest place to work and live online. And it's that's the kind of work that we build towards in all of our advice and guidance. So cracking on, I think we can all agree that 2020 has been an interesting year by any definition. And for NCSC, we've done a lot of different work than we were planning, shall we say. So specifically in relation to what's happened this year, we've done a lot of work on home working, advice and guidance both for individuals who are now working home and for enterprises. So we've done a lot of work on that. We've also done a lot of work specifically on video conferencing technology, how to use it safely in a secure manner, how to run it from an enterprise point of view. We've also done a lot of work on helping companies who predominantly before COVID were physically based. So for example, retailers who had shop fronts and so on and so forth, and who are now having to pivot their whole business model to a more online focus, and helping them come to terms with the different threats and different operating models they have to adhere to in that case there. All this information, by the way, is on our website, and using straightforward terms, go to ncsc.gov.uk and you can find all this information on there to download and use. As well as work to support UK business and citizens, we've also been doing a lot of work before this, but also more focused on supporting our academic and our research community. We had work prior to this on helping people work out how to sort of protect and look after their research data. But now, the last 6 months, we have been working quite specifically with certain universities and certain research groups to support their COVID research. And we're now working through all that effort to try and get the vaccine to the UK market as soon as possible. So as well as all that kind of general supporting stuff here, I'm here to talk to you about specifically about some of the stuff more geared towards strategic and executive teams and groups. Hopefully some of you would have heard about a thing we call the board toolkit. Now the board toolkit, as it probably isn't like a specific piece of guidance that can be read in one go. The idea is that the boards and executive teams can dip into the toolkit as and when they need to get a feel for stuff. And it's at this point here I'd like to quickly open a poll we're going to ask you to look at. So here we go. So here's the poll now. So how often does your board have an in-depth discussion about cyber risk management? And while you're thinking about your answer there, I'm going to quickly talk about some of the things that the board toolkit can do. So have a look at the question and consider this. So the board toolkit is a set of different ways of thinking about cybersecurity. It's written in a language we hope that boards will recognize and be able to interpret. And also poses different types of questions and potential answers and things you're going to get presented to you from your security and your risk teams. The idea is the toolkit, you can dip into it and take bits out of it for different types of meetings, different things affect your company, incidents happen, different types of impacts to your organization. So the board toolkit is there to help you understand and work with security in a sensible manner. So as well as a toolkit, another piece of guidance that we produced is on our cyber insurance. So again, information is to type in insurance on our website in the search bar, you'll find it. We've done a lot of work with the cyber insurance industry in the UK to try and establish cyber insurance in a way which is useful and you understand what you're buying. We know that lots of people have got cyber insurance now, but actually, what have you bought? What does it cover? What risks does it manage? How can you use it? How are you going to implement the insurance if in doubt you have an incident that needs it? So again, we've got some good guidance on there of how to use and incorporate insurance into your risk modelling. As well as all of that, another tool which I think could be interesting to everyone is what we call exercise in the box. This is a online, well, there are online elements to it, also a desk-based system. So you can do desktop exercising of testing your various security responses to different effects. If there was a phishing attack on your infrastructure, ransomware, insider threat, those sort of things. And you can test yourselves against the exercise. You can download it and run it, a bit like a role-playing game, really. And then run it again 6 months later once you've learned the lessons. And you can do that in a safe environment, all yourself. It's all free to download. So again, look for exercise in the box on our website and have a read for that. It's very useful stuff. But what does all that mean? And we'll come back to the test results in a second, I think. Actually, is it possible to show up the results now? There we go. So that's an interesting stat there. So once a year is the main one there, but the twice and three times obviously splits it broadly as well. And honestly, that kind of aligns with a lot of our findings as well. When we go out there and talk about our board toolkit with different boards and different groups, we do find that different companies and different organized sectors are maturing in different ways. And you'll hear a reference later on about the whole sort of safety and security cultures that evolved in different areas. But we found that now with the board toolkit, that can help establish talking about cybersecurity on a regular basis. And we found that if it becomes a regular basis, becomes a pattern, and becomes a sort of a standard way of thinking about it. So hopefully I'd see that stat grow to swing down to the at least three times a year on a regular basis discussing cybersecurity, and the board toolkit can help. So cutting to the chase now, why is this important? Now, the normal stuff is still important with cybersecurity. Good cybersecurity makes your organization more resilient, protects your information assets, supports you when you have to be regulated, stops sort of old school sort of theft and so on there. But one thing that I'm trying to push across, the NCSC is really keen to promote, is that good security equates to trust. This is trust between your management and your staff, trust between your organization, your customers, trust between your business partners, trust between you and your regulators. If you've got that trust and you can show it and demonstrate it clearly by your security, be it via audits or be it via demonstration, you've got certain tools and stuff in place and how you respond to an incident, that trust can open and equals opportunity. Easier to facilitate quicker sales if you've got a trust relationship between you and your customer. Business deals between business partners can be quickened up if you've got that trust. Working practices can improve if you've got that underlying foundation of security. So the whole trust model builds on good security. And if you see it in that context, that can often help you move forward with your security implementation. So finishing off my piece here, really, security has the ability to underpin the new working practices that C19 in the COVID year so far has pushed on us, working at home, working remotely, dealing things with a completely cyber focus. So with good security, we can embed those so they become the new normal in lots of places. Without security, a lot of these things just won't work properly, so you can get security in place. And I think the takeaway really is to make sure that seeing that security is a catalyst for positive change and shouldn't be seen as a blocker. So that's what NCSC is trying to push in lots of our ways, really. So thank you for listening to me ramble on about security and trust. I hope it's found interesting. I'm going to hand over to Larry. He's going to do a really informative talk. We heard it yesterday about security culture. So Larry, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. Welcome, everybody. Good morning to you all. I'd like to use the next few minutes to look at the need to establish an all-encompassing positive cybersecurity culture from the boardroom to the front line. Some 20 plus years ago, when I was presenting IT technology to the boards of companies, I often received dismissive responses like, "This is the responsibility of the CIO who reports to the CFO." In the last decade, a typical response to presentations regarding the risks of cybersecurity weakness or failures has typically been, "They report through the risk committee, who report to the board through the audit committee." CSO who? Indeed, the potential financial impacts were not considered significant enough to warrant board attention. Delegation, dismissal, and silence based on the lack of knowledge or understanding by those present, not wishing to be embarrassed. Another parallel between IT and cybersecurity at board level has been the complexity of the subject matter and the lack of experience or knowledge. In recent years, the impact of cybersecurity has become not just operational, but ever more strategic. The need for strong cybersecurity resilience following recent political changes to the global economy have been multiplied by the recent pandemic. This has accelerated the need for companies, their employees, the executive team, and the board to respond and act urgently and significantly. A positive security culture needs to be deployed, executed, and totally supported across the entire business, its people, and also the external interfaces. When Lou Gerstner said to me when he joined IBM, until I came here, I would have said that culture was just one among several important elements in any organization's makeup and success, along with vision, strategy, marketing, and financials. He then said, now I realize that culture isn't just one aspect of the game, it is the game. Strong leadership is essential from the very top of the boardroom to the front line. Positive encouragement with recognition and reward. Blame culture is totally unacceptable in an organization. Success in this space going forward is key to reputation and business performance throughout the entire supply chain. Another significant factor in the need for a positive cyber culture has been the increase in awareness of the human impact of the cyber threat. A strong defense capability is no longer good enough. We need to build the ability to detect an attack, react quickly, and recover as efficiently as possible. This makes demands on the use of technology, but even more so to the sensitivity, the know-how, and confidence of the employees in detecting, reporting, and solving these problems. Indeed, to most boards these days, I'd say the board mantra should become, from the boardroom to the front line, we are committed to utilizing cyber resilience to differentiate ourselves, building greater trust with our customers and our suppliers. In my 9 years at IBM, I experienced a really good example of this culture style being implemented across the entire entity at the Board of Mighty. Complete commitment to health and safety at all levels. Clearly, the impact at human level is very significant in that business because of the nature of what the people do from a health and safety perspective. But everybody was aware of the impact to the financials, to the shareholders, the market, our partners, and our clients. Every board meeting opened with a report on health and safety from the previous period. We had the statistics on people as well as the financial impact. We discussed the results of previous actions we had implemented and taken, and then we discussed what we needed to do going forward. In addition, at board level, we recognized the award winners and also studied the employee opinion survey at regular intervals. Indeed, all employees were encouraged to learn, report, respond, and recommend in a positive way. Celebration of contribution was through both financial reward and peer recognition, including an annual award ceremony, which was attended and led by the chair, the CEO, and the board. It was part of everything we did and understood. We constantly adapted our approach. Cybersecurity needs to be treated the same. Every board meeting should have a cybersecurity review presented by the lead of the company's cybersecurity committee. At least one NED should attend the prior committee meetings. Clearly, that NED should have knowledge in this space, as indeed those NEDs who represent and attend audit, nomination, and remuneration committee meetings. I believe cybersecurity external advisors should also be appointed to attend these meetings, as well as being more involved on a regular basis. Some companies have already taken this step one further and appointed a cyber risk security committee at board level, chaired and attended by more than one NED or board executive. Thought needs to be given to communications, internal and external, both formal and informal, including at the AGM and the contents of the annual board report, etc. I personally believe that formal demands will become more prevalent. And at this point, I'd like to take the opportunity to put a poll question in front of you. And this poll question should fundamentally be, should there be more formal governance requirements around cyber security? I'd welcome your comments. Can we have the poll results as soon as possible? Thank you. Today, there is a key demand for education and continued sharing of knowledge. We must work together on this with multiple parties. One in particular for me is the sharing and telling of stories, allowing communication that is understandable, accessible, and executable at all levels. As I said at the very beginning, from the front line to the boardroom. This will make cybersecurity resilience a significant accessory to the reputation and the performance of a successful company. Thank you for your time listening to me. And now let me introduce the next speaker, who is Richard Knowlton, the former director of Group Corporate Security in Vodafone, and now the director of security studies at the Oxford Cyber Academy. Thank you, Richard.
Thank you very much, Larry, and good morning, everybody. What's it going to take to be successful after the COVID crisis? And I guess this is the $64,000 question at the moment. I'm asked it wherever I go. And I think probably my answer would be in two parts. First of all, of course, we should already be thinking through the lessons we've learned from the crisis. And second, we should be seeing what changes we need to make to our business models to ensure that we do well in the new normal. Obviously, this thinking is going to cover lots of management issues, from a whole bunch of HR questions to supply chain to whether we really need to maintain the same office space as before. But that thinking must also consider security. If there's one trend that's been accelerating off the chart during the crisis, it's the criminal threat to our IP, operations, sensitive data, and ultimately, of course, to our profits. From my experience over the last 15 years, I'd say the average senior exec or director only rarely thinks much about security. When I first became a security director, I had one-to-one get-to-know-you sessions with each member of my executive committee. Before I'd even started my first meeting, the director concerned looked at me wearily and said, "Look, I have the faintest idea what your department does. I suppose you're a bit like those people in tax." To be fair, that view was understandable at the time. Security was simply not an executive committee issue. It was a cost of doing business. Those costs were relatively low, while any losses were marginal, even in higher risk sectors like telecoms or financial services. But everything has changed. Cyber attacks are a constant threat to all organizations. They're unavoidable and inevitable, and some of them will succeed. When they do, they can cause huge damage to your business, not to speak of the stress to you and your people. Now, we can see the change of mood through the annual surveys of the impact of cyber attacks on business that the government's been carrying out since 2016. The latest survey, published in March, shows that 80% of businesses now say that cybersecurity is a high priority for their senior management boards. That's 80%, up from 69% in the first survey 4 years ago in 2016. Call me cynical, I'd say the trick is to translate that high priority into meaningful action. So what to do? Of course, you must have the right security people, the right technology, and the right processes. But if we get one message across today, it must be that cybersecurity is not just about hardware and software. The main thing that you need to get right is the security culture in your organization. If you have a culture where security is not a priority, you can't successfully manage attacks on your business. The best organizations know this. Their security culture is central to who they are and what they represent. And Larry spoke just now about his experience in Mighty in this context. But if you don't already have that strong security culture, how do you go about changing it? Well, I've seen firsthand how strong action can transform an unresponsive culture. 10 years ago or so, the board of Vodafone Group acknowledged that far too many of its people were dying or being seriously injured in industrial accidents. Something had to be done. The Executive Committee approved 5 golden rules for health and safety. To be honest, none of them were rocket science. They included the use of hard hats and safety harnesses on engineering sites and the wearing of seat belts in company vehicles. The company drummed these golden rules into all employees at every opportunity, and the campaign was driven hard from the top. Rather as in Mighty, as Larry explained, at every ExCo meeting, the CEO and the HR director spent time going through the latest health and safety incidents and the lessons learned from them. The annual senior leadership team meeting of Vodafone's top 200 executives spent an hour looking at performance against the golden rules. A main presentation showed photos of each worker killed or injured in the previous period, with a brief description of their work and their families. In other words, the situation was personalised. It was extraordinary how quickly behaviour changed. Within weeks, my drivers in Africa or in India refused even to start their vehicles until I'd done up my seatbelt. It was becoming part of the culture of the company that the golden rules had to be obeyed. How many organisations have thought of taking the same approach to their security culture? Cyber incidents, of course, might not have the same life or death consequences as safety accidents, but they can certainly leave a company fighting for its life. So, my conclusion, you, your boards and your top management will be looking to reshape the future of your organisation after the COVID-19 crisis. An important part of that review must be a reset of your organisation's security values and culture. Thank you for listening. I'm now going to hand over to Nick Wilding, who's the General Manager of Cyber Resilience in Axelos Recipio. Thank you.
Many thanks, Richard. Good morning, everyone. I don't believe you'll be able to see me, sadly. My webcam isn't working, but I think my wife will probably suggest that that's probably a good thing for all of you. So good morning to you all. I run Resilia within Axelos Global Best Practice. We focus on helping organisations tackle their human factor in their organisational resilience through innovative training and engagement across the workforce. During my short chat this morning, I just want to outline why and how organisations need to engage with all their employees effectively in mitigating the reputational, financial and operational damage of a cyber attack. I'd like to start by just reading out a letter from someone, or an extract from a letter from someone I know well, a guy called Jim Baines. He's the chief exec of a company called Baines Packaging. And he wrote an open letter to peers of his after he fell victim to a cyber attack. Let me just read out the extract. As a CEO, it never occurred to me that I might be a target. In fact, we're actually the best and biggest targets. We know all the secrets. We have privileged access to all the sensitive and lucrative parts of our business. We must remember we're just as human as everyone else. We make mistakes. We can be careless. In fact, we can be vulnerable because we think we're immune. And that's what I thought. My company, which I've built from nothing over 30 years, is now losing clients, money, and most importantly, our reputation was in tatters. I'm fighting back, but it's hard. You need to know that you and everyone on your board, as well as all of your employees, are targets. We have to remember that at the end of every system, at the end of every process, and every bit of technology is a person. No one's immune, however powerful or successful we may be. You need to know that and act now. The consequence of doing nothing is typically painful and expensive, as I've found to my cost. So a very impassioned plea from Jim there, and I'll come back to Jim at the end of my little talk. We've heard about the COVID crisis and the impact of the lockdown, and it's clear that we are now working in a new working environment, and that's bringing profound changes to how and where we work now and well into the future. I really believe we have to be very careful not to underestimate the new and different pressures that all of our employees face whilst working from home. It's a fundamentally new environment in which we're expecting them to work safely and securely. And once one of the speakers said earlier, it's one of the big, I think it was Richard's just now, one of the things that's really happened during the uh, the lockdowns, the massive spike in coronavirus-related cyber attacks. So in talking with our clients, it's clear there's been a Herculean effort from executive teams and security leaders to effectively manage the immediate strategic and security impacts brought about by having a remote workforce. It's apparent that digital transformation projects and investment are being fast-tracked as part of this response. And as a result, practical cyber risk management programs that are aligned to the overall business goals and objectives are becoming even more difficult to design, implement, and manage. And sadly, I see security often playing catch up rather than being an integral part of these strategic projects and discussions. On the other side of the fence, the cyber criminals have exploited the lockdown to their advantage, using COVID as the hook for millions of new and simple attacks. From the cyber criminals' view, whoever they are, wherever they live, they are usually intelligent, organized, and highly agile. Their operations and MOs evolve and adapt quickly, using often simple techniques to target us. In my work with organizations in developing their their security awareness strategy and training, it's been evident to me over the last few years that cyber criminals are often more successful at communicating and engaging with and influencing the behaviors of our employees than we are. It is all too easy. So how big is the human factor in maintaining our resilience, and how can we help our workforce make the right decisions at the right time in the face of growing cyber attacks at home and in the workplace? In the same research that Richard mentioned just now, the UK government cybersecurity breaches survey this year, it reported that by far the most disruptive type of attack that organizations face is fraudulent emails being directed to fraudulent websites. In other words, phishing. All these attacks start with people. We're the interface between the criminals and the target of their attack. Similarly, Telstra carried out global security research last year, and they with security practitioners. And one of the key findings there was the greatest risk to our business and IT security is human error. The harsh reality is that 90%, it's often reported that at least 90% of successful cyber attacks will start with any one of us. It's the unwitting mistakes that we can make during our busy and stressful day-to-day working lives that can have a disastrous and lasting impact on our organizations. So I'd say that our employees really do need to be engaged more effectively to become our last and effective line of defense. The sad truth is that we've known all of this for many, many years, but little's changed in the ways we train and educate ourselves and our people in developing positive security cultures. Imagine a situation where people always remember the things they're supposed to do for security, always do those things at the right times and in the right circumstances, and prioritize doing things in secured ways when needed. All too often, we hear about and read about people being the weakest link. It's wrong. Our employees, all of us, must be and can be our strongest defense against growing cyber attacks and their business impacts. I typically say that our organizational resilience and security is a team sport. It's not just down to one person or a small team of technical specialists. We're all vulnerable and we all have our specific role to play. We're trying to change behaviors. We need to think differently in engaging or wanting to change behaviors. Please, no more annual one-off training exercises. No more compliance-based tick box training. No more boring, patronizing and irrelevant training. All of these will have no impact on our employees' behaviours. Instead, let's start listening to our employees and colleagues to better understand the difficulties they have in complying with security policies. We need to fit security and their policies around our people, not the other way around. As the NCSC recently said, security that doesn't work for people simply doesn't work. Let's make secure behaviors easy to do and provide the right motivation and prompts to do the right thing. Let's make security awareness engaging, targeted, relevant, and ongoing. And it should also be fun. Let's use the power of storytelling to demystify and encourage us to share our own experiences with friends and colleagues, which is a critical tool in our in our kit bag, I think. You know, we really need to get to a situation where the culture and environment allows us to speak freely with our friends, the water cooler discussions, or the discussions we can have on calls about sharing mistakes that we might have made. And that's the success of stories. They're all around us. They're not mere entertainment. They're how we build business and cultures. That's what stories are for. They instruct us, inspire us, and warn us. We learn what to do and what not to do through stories. And that brings me back to Jim Baines, whose letter I read out at the beginning. Jim's actually a fictional character, albeit based on a number of real life characters. When I started at Axelos and started leading Resilia, it was apparent to me that a story, it's a CEO cyber thriller that we've written called Whaling for Beginners, can have a real impact on the way particularly executives can perceive and understand the nature of the risks that they're facing. The feedback we've had to the book has been fantastic. I'm holding a copy up now, though I suspect you can't see it. So if you do want a copy, please do let us know. I believe we've got a significant language gap to fill, and it's already been mentioned by the other speakers. The security and cyber industry has created an aura and a language that's out of reach to most of us. We need to be talking from a business perspective and translating cyber security, cyber resilience, whatever we want to call it, into a business language. We have to demystify cyber and security by making it real and relevant and simple to understand. Einstein said, if you can't explain it simply, you don't understand it well enough. So finally, let's bridge that information gap with our people and ensure we develop the positive security cultures that will help build the trust, secure our supply chains, and create those new competitive strengths in a world where trust is clearly going to be ever more vital for profitable business. That's the end of my short chat. I'll hand you over back now to Karen, who's I think going to manage the Q&A session.
Oh, Nick, thanks very much indeed. And thank you to all five of our speakers this morning, because I think one of the key messages that is coming around, several key messages really around storytelling, the power of stories in terms of helping us to engage and really understand rather than those dry facts. Something about really taking note of the language we use when talking to people so we don't get caught up in jargon. What does data risk really mean? What are the words that are going to really engage our people? And I think the other thing is that linking those two together is this whole subject of the power of culture, creating an all-encompassing culture where the risk to our data is a risk to our customers, a risk to our people. So actually linking it together in a very human sense came through really clearly for me. And I'd like to ask our panelists, all of them, to come back on screen and to open up their audio so that we can get to some of the questions. We've got some really great ones, gentlemen. So without further ado, I'd like to kick straight off. And the first one is to you, James, and obviously anybody else who has any comments around this. Who should ideally form a cybersecurity committee within an organisation? And if the board are supported by a committee in IT, what training would you recommend they actually need to do? Quite a big question there. So effectively, who should ideally form that committee, and where should the board be supporting that committee and IT, and what training do you see is needed?
Yeah, okay. So I think on that committee, you definitely need a mix of people with the technical understanding, so somebody from the CIO or IT function. But just as importantly, we'd see that as being this risk within the organization. I think as we've talked about a lot in the various discussions, it's only through that bringing it in line with the rest of your risk management processes and language will the board be able to understand and engage with that. And in terms of the training required for boards, it is that the translation of the gap between the cyber risk and other business risks, and some of the examples that Richard was talking about, you know, facilitated walkthroughs of some of the online games and the NCSC board toolkit can be really useful starting places, and also just reaching out and understanding in their industry, their type of their size, what has really been going on? Because a lot of people will look at the headlines about attacks on very large organizations and therefore continue to think it's just about being targeted by large organizations. So it's understanding what the real scale of the threat is out there from volume cyber criminals.
James, we're having trouble with your internet connection flowing naturally. So just wanted to open up that same question to the others. What other thoughts have you got, gentlemen?
So can I make a comment at this point? Sorry, Richard, you go first.
You sure?
Yeah.
I just want to quickly add that a diversity on any kind of panel is really important to get that range of thoughts. Like James said, yeah, you want people involved in from risk and technical backgrounds is brilliant. But also understanding how security impacts different members of your company, be it gender, race, age, etc., all those kind of things as well, is really important, because we've noticed definitely the lockdown and working at home has a big impact on loads of different types of people. And the same with security. Certain security concepts will impact different groups and different members of your community in different ways. So having that diversity is really, really key to making sure that any ideas and things you roll out are going to have the maximum impact. That'd be a takeaway from that point of view. Richard, please take the floor.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that, Richard. I think my add-on to that would be diversity in every sense. And actually, in a cyber incident, the whole range of people across the company, marketing, commercial, operations, legal, and never to be left out, communications people, because in a crisis, they're going to have to handle the internal communication around what's happening, and also the people dealing with the press. My experience of major incidents is that those people have to be involved in planning from the beginning. After all, they're going to be the public face of the company when something bad happens.
And I'll just, thanks, Richard. I'll just also, Karen, finally add that, you know, you talk about the public face, Richard, within the organisation, your organisations as well, you know, you are the public face to staff as well. And I think it's cyber security, cyber resilience, cyber attacks is a great opportunity for the executive management teams to share their own experiences of information security, some of the challenges that they faced with all of their staff and involving and collaborating with the staff. And totally agree with Richard from the NCSC, you know, on any team, please do involve people that are on the front line as well. They are critical. They all tell you the things that are working and not working when it comes to security and the policies that you have.
Karen, yeah. Could I respond?
Yeah.
Just supporting a couple of the comments and then a separate one. I think it's so, so important that people comprehend this is beyond technology and the human aspect of this risk. One of the reasons I joined when invited by the NCSC to join the board of the Research Institute in Socio-Technical Cybersecurity was simply the focus upon what is happening with the humans. And that phrase of just the title of the board changed to include socio on that basis. But the thing that always makes people smile when I talk to them is that there are more psychologists on the board and advising us from universities than there are IT people. Now, clearly, I know I'll struggle in that environment, but seriously, that's what attracted me to it, and that's what everybody needs to focus on. And within that, taking into account the entire population of the employees, one of the things that I would suggest at any board level, any executive level, is to create what I call a red team. And typically you can get somebody like me or somebody from the outside, James, Richard, and Nick, anybody that you know, to come and help lead that. But it's picking people across the entire organization. And typically what you're looking for is people who in the future are likely to be running it, but there are also significant people leaders within the organization right down to the front line. And you set the red team the mission of, come back every now and then with how you would take this business down and how you would attack it, and then sit together and figure out, because seriously, their ability to contribute is enormous, but their ability to learn and understand and then become observant is key. Thank you.
Wow, really fantastic advice and many different perspectives. And actually, I think the next question follows on really nicely from these points. And that is, could each of you comment around the whole subject of storytelling? We've been talking a lot, haven't we, about the humanising of this message and the making it authentic, bringing the individual stories of cyber attacks and potential risk to individuals as well as organisations. And I appreciate the need for anonymity, I should say here, but it'd be just great to get your thoughts on two things, really. One, what is the most powerful story you've heard, you've been given, that's really resonated for you? And why did it resonate? And it'd be great to get one from each of you. Who'd like to start?
I'll kick that off, Karen. It's Nick. We are... absolutely passionate about the power of storytelling across all organisations. Sadly, a lot of the stories we hear are negative. They're about attacks. One recently, I was speaking to a group chief executive of a FTSE 250 company who told me about a whaling attack, similar to Jim Baines, who is a fictional character, but this is real life. This was just before lockdown. Their systems had been compromised. The criminals were gathering information about the chief executive and the finance director, worked out that there was a particular project that they were working on, and pretended to be an organization that they were working with outside. No details about the organisation for obvious reasons, but the result of that was that they lost £400,000. The sad truth about that story was that there were many, many red flags, as my contact was telling me, that should have been raised during that process that happened. It happened over a period of a few days, but there were many red flags that should have, and involved many other people in finance and in executive assistance, that they should have said, hang on, this just looks a little bit too suspicious. So that's the sad thing. The on the positive side, I've also seen organizations, one of my clients has used and taken that idea of storytelling to a new level, where they have competitions with their staff about storytelling, asking them to produce a short story, 100 words, 500 words, or a short video or a short film about their issues, their concerns, some ideas around the role that all of us should be playing in the resilience of our organisations. So hopefully that helps. But as you say, the idea of stories based on real life incidents is a very, very powerful tool, particularly one where it's related to a particular industry and those within that industry can relate to that.
Thanks, Nick. Who'd like to go next?
Shall I go next? Going back to something that Larry was talking about with red teaming, one technique I found very effective in several companies is to make what you're saying, your story you're telling, as personal as possible to the individual. So what we've done on several occasions is to carry out a quick open source survey of an individual director, for example, just to look at their social media exposure in terms of themselves, their partner, and their children, if they have any, and just produce one side of a piece of paper with all the information that you gleaned. Most people are astonished when they find out, when they're confronted with what is easily available about them. And then, of course, you can put that directly into the red team context. Anybody looking to fish or whale or spearfish you, look at how much material they've actually got available to do it. And generally speaking, I found that has a pretty galvanizing effect on senior executives in particular.
Thanks, Richard.
Shall I go ahead, Karen?
Yeah, please do, Larry.
I thought long and hard about this question coming up, and I was sort of being quite patient. Then, following on from Richard, I raised the red team issue for key reasons, and he's just commented. So here's one I will briefly share with you, and the significance of this is it absolutely is true because it's me. And so this is a story that nobody else knows other than 10 people in a room and a couple of others. okay? But fundamentally, I was invited along with two or three members of Richard and the NCSC to a board. This company is a large commercial property company. And I was invited by the audit chairman, who happens to be a good friend, and I'd been on a board with him as well. Anyway, net-net, I stood up at the end of three presentations from the intelligence services and then basically stood there. And before I spoke, the CFO said, "Oh, Larry, fantastic, lovely to see you." He said, "Just so you know," and he named an IT company, "they've just finished a complete review and we are one of the most secure companies they've ever come across." So I thought for about 30 seconds and I basically said, "Okay, well, look, we're on the 20th floor of a building in the boardroom and, you know, clearly there's dinner here. Imagine in 2 days' time, you have sold the building and your board's going to meet with the board of the company who's just bought a 30-story building and you're all going to go upstairs, meet in the lift, go up to the top and be in the boardroom and then have a wonderful lunch. Fantastic. The only problem is you get to the 17th floor, the lift stops and the phone goes. And it basically says, we'd like you to put 45 million using Bitcoin in the following accounts as we speak. Please do it now. Otherwise, this lift is going to the floor. Thank you very much. Oh, by the way, sorry, we've sold both of your shares short on the stock market this morning. I got an interesting reaction from the board. Thought I'd share that with you. Thank you.
So Richard, I can jump in quickly with one. So one useful method for storytelling that we found is to give people a chance to realize that bad things happen, and just because it happens to them doesn't make them a bad person. So phishing, ransomware happens quite a lot. We all know about that. But telling stories that where it explains that even experts, people that understand this and research this for a living, can still get tricked in the right circumstances. Two versions of this. So I was listening to a podcast the other day which summarized it quite nicely. This guy was going to go, literally was going to go to, I think it was DEF CON or one of the big security conferences, and he was getting ready to do that event. And in the pressured moment of him trying to basically move his office from where he lived in America to Las Vegas for that week, he was getting everything ready. Looked at an email which said, "Oh, your Amazon order is ready, or there's a problem with it." And he was in a stress situation, and he clicked things through. And it was only all these triggers, I think we mentioned just now, about all these things, that all these red flags were there, but he was in a stress situation and didn't follow his own internal processes. And it was only right at the end, when he was about to I think he'd already clicked the link, basically he'd already got to the point where he's about to enter some information. Then he went, "Hang on." And he did the basic stuff, looked at some of the URLs, and it linked to a random Russian website. So it wasn't like a well-written bit of ransomware. But it was just to put across that even if you're an expert in certain things, if the timing's right, we're all human, things happen. And the trick in that case wasn't to be embarrassed that you've been conned. It's to be understanding that, okay, this has happened. I need to, now what do I do? How do I report it? And how can I fix it quickly? Because I have seen a personal situation, a colleague of mine, their parents in a similar situation got caught in this cycle, and the bad guys are trying to sort of get them to do things quickly, keep them on their toes. That's how they work. And I had to explain to them that in some of these situations, you've got whole enterprises and whole industries designed to write perfect scripts to keep you on your toes, to say the right things in a certain way, know how the banks work in your country. And they've got people that are experts in doing that. And as an individual citizen, it's very hard for you to try and compete against that. So obviously we try and educate people and do the right thing, but there's a backup plan. Is that if bad things happen, try and know what to do to fix it afterwards. And as an organization and as board members, you can have that in place and just say, look, people are going to con you, us individuals from the board down. We're trying to do our best to not make this happen, but here's what happens if it goes wrong. And so you can use a story to make people feel better that they can fix these things.
Thank you so much. So I think there's been many opportunities to learn from this webinar. It's been really helpful hearing those stories. And I would just iterate that you have five people here who have a tremendous amount of experience to share. And whether it's something you're interested to do with the training kits that are available, which we'll send information out on, or indeed the different services that we can provide and support you as an organisation. I think the overwhelming message is speak to the experts. They've been there, they've done it. And at some tight stages paid a bit of the price alongside that. And actually bringing people who have had that human experience combined with a knowledge of what's going on in the industry right now is really valuable. And I'd like to thank James and all our panellists today for a really fascinating webinar. Thanks to you all for joining us again, as always, this week. Any comments and feedback that you'd like to give us around any future content, please do let us know, because we'd love to put these on for you. And we will be in contact with you with a follow-up to this webinar so that you've got a link. Any contact to our guest speakers, also we can facilitate that. So for now, on closing at 11 o'clock, I'd like to say on behalf of everyone, thank you very much indeed, and look forward to seeing you soon. Thank you.